from Hollywood. I'm Martin Grove, welcoming you to our Screendollars podcast, Box Office Autopsy. Right now, we'll look at the movie marketplace and analyze how things are going and where they're going, sharing some opinions from my perspective after decades of talking about Hollywood on CNN Entertainment Tonight and as a Hollywood Reporter columnist. Well, we made it to 2022. Not just us, but Exhibition, which dodged a bullet called day-and-date streaming. Now it's on to what looks like it should be a much better year at the box office. This one, according to Comscore, added up to about $4.5 billion. In 2022, projections right here on Screendollars from Gower Street Analytics in London are for a little over $9 billion. So let's hope that all comes to pass. It's obviously very early in the new year. But in any event, we'll be following it closely right here on Box Office Autopsy. Meanwhile, there were no wide openings to end 2021. Instead, moviegoers rang in the new year with Sony and Marvel's third weekend of Spider-Man No Way Home. After we check out how Spidey did, we'll look ahead to some January openings, and we'll kick off our new Oscar Outlook feature, today spotlighting Steven Spielberg's awards contender West Side Story. But first, Spider-Man No Way Home. The global cum is now officially $1.4 billion. That includes nearly $610 million in domestic grosses. It's the year's top-grossing movie, surprise, and it's the 10th highest-grossing film of all time domestically, and the 12th biggest film ever worldwide. It was number one in weekend three with nearly $53 million, and it was down just 38%. So a very, very good hold, but again, no real competition. The weekend's only other holdover hit was Universal and Illumination's animated comedy adventure Sing 2, which placed second in its second weekend. It did just under $20 million. It was only down 12%. Bringing the domestic cum to just under $90 million. Now, we know that's families going to the movies. The doomsayers have been telling us for weeks and weeks, families? They're not going to go near the movies. They're scared to go. They don't want to expose their children. Well, children now, young children, are able to be vaccinated. A great many have been. And families seem to be less fearful about going to the movies than some of the media people have led us to believe, or they've tried to lead us to believe, I guess, is a better way to put that. In any event, family moving going is back. Encanto from Disney Animation also performed very, very strongly, opening way back at Thanksgiving. But Encanto is still on the box office top 10 now, number 10. It did a little over $1 million for the New Year's weekend, and its cum is now almost $92 million. So clearly, family movie going is alive and well. Now, looking on to other films in the marketplace, nothing else was doing well. Disney and 20th's Kingsman prequel was number three with about $4.5 million. It's done $19.5 million, so nothing good there. And then a really huge disappointment is Warner's The Matrix Resurrections. It was number five for the weekend with $3.8 million, and the cum domestically is about $31 million. The killer for The Matrix Resurrections was day-and-date streaming on HBO Max. It's astounding. It did very well there. The Samba TV people who measure streaming ratings and viewership said that in its first 5 days, the picture did about 2.8 million views. Now, if you figure that's around 5 million people, and if you say, well, the average ticket price for adults, and especially at big theaters, premium format theaters, is somewhere towards $13, you multiply that out, there's about $65 million that did not go into the theatrical box office for Matrix Resurrections. And boy, if it had, they'd be singing a different tune. So that's what day-and-date streaming can do. In any event, let's move on to the first big opening of 2022, January 7th, and that is Universal and Film Nation's PG-13 action thriller, The 355. And when I said big opening, I just meant high-profile opening, because here there's going to be most likely more action on the screen than there is at the box office. Its all-star cast of global female spies includes Diane Kruger, Penelope Cruz, Jessica Chastain, Lupita Nyong'o, and Bing Bing Fan. And here they are in action. And that was the cast of The 355, definitely in action, serious action. Well, 355 is tracking below norm for first choice. It's got an average score for first choice that's 3 points below norm. Its top demo is a tie with older men over 25, 3 points below norm, and older women over 25, 2 points below norm. Only good news here, there is no day-and-date streaming. Okay, sorry, Peacock, you don't have The 355. Yet. January 14th, which starts the Martin Luther King Jr. birthday weekend, will bring exhibitors something to shout about, and that's Scream. That's from Paramount and Spyglass Entertainment. It's an R-rated horror reboot, and Nev Campbell, Courtney Cox, and David Arquette are returning from the 1996 original. Let's listen in now as they discuss what makes Ghostface so scary.
What makes a good horror movie? I think a really strong villain, an iconic silhouette. And then you see that white skull face, and you're like, ah!
You can be laughing 1 second, but then as soon as Ghostface is out there with a knife, like, you're really scared.
You see Ghostface and, like, your breath catches, because you know what that means.
It's so great because it's so ominous and scary because you don't know who's underneath it. Anybody can be Ghostface.
Hello, Sydney. Would you like to play a game?
Ghostface is a killer that is about playing games, but when it comes time to do the job, it's really brutal and really violent.
It's so intimidating when the knife is in the hand, and just so scary. When you put that music with that bass, he is scary as unlock ever.
Well, if you ever wondered what it was that made Ghostface so scary, you now know. In any case, Scream's tracking shows strong want-to-see from older teens and young adults. Its top demo is under 25 females, and they are already more than twice the norm. So, very good news on the Scream front. skipping to the end of January, the 28th of the month, will bring an injection of box office gold from Sony and Marvel for the PG-13 action thriller Morbius, starring Jared Leto as a biochemist trying to cure his own rare blood disorder, who accidentally infects himself with a much worse form of vampirism. Here is a quick look at how Dr. Morpheus's transformation goes.
This could be my last chance.
You can buckle me up.
Yeah. Great.
The moment of truth.
I call.
You're bringing out the big guns. Yeah.
Let's go, Dan.
Shouldn't be down here.
I can be wherever I want, nurse.
It's doctor, actually.
You're still the help, just like me.
Get out. Michael?
Well, as you can see, the transformation of Dr. Morpheus did not go well. To see more, see the movie. In any case, Morbius is tracking great. It's got average definite interest already that's 14 points over norm. And we know that's going to grow because we've got a whole month of January to go before the picture hits theaters. Once again, Sony and Marvel giving theaters that box office boost. As the award season heats up, which it is as we speak, we will be looking here on Box Office Autopsy at the contenders in our brand new weekly feature, Oscar Outlook, starting today with Disney and 20th Century Studios' musical drama, West Side Story. That's Steven Spielberg's take on the celebrated 1957 stage production. Let's listen as Spielberg talks about making the movie and why he wanted to make the movie.
There's a place for us. Somewhere, a place for us.
This is a tradition on all of our movies where we toast the first shot and we toast the last shot. And I just want to say that we have been actually in production on this for months. The choreography, the dance rehearsals, the music. We've all been doing this with Gustavo Dudamel and David Newman conducting the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. Janine Tesori's work, getting everybody primed and ready to sing these great songs, as great as anybody has ever sung them. But now to actually bring all those elements together as one voice into an ensemble. It's a very relevant story.
Why not your own kind? Stick to your own kind.
To the times we now live in. I'm just so proud and honored that I got this shot late in my career of being able to tell this story directly based on the 1957 Broadway musical.
Go!
Skyscrapers blooming America, Cadillacs zooming America, industry booming America.
I'm so proud to be here.
Amazing! Yeah.
West Side Story, definitely a contender for awards and a top high-profile director, Steven Spielberg, to talk about making it. West Side Story is critically acclaimed. It's got 92% fresh on Rotten Tomatoes. It's got great word of mouth, 94% audience score there. but it didn't resonate at the box office over the holidays. Maybe because adult moviegoers are coming back more slowly than younger moviegoers, but who knows? Maybe the timing wasn't right. It opened the 10th of December. Well, that's the period of December when people are busy doing holiday shopping, going to holiday parties, and they don't have movie going on their mind quite yet. And it didn't really snap back over Christmas as some of us thought it might, but award success would help it. It would help it find its audience. So it's a good sign that West Side Story has already received 11 Critics' Choice Awards nominations, including for Best Picture and Director. Those are the essentials. You got to have those if you're going to have any serious hopes of winning. Tying, by the way, with Focus Features, Kenneth Branagh, Drama Belfast, for the most Critics' Choice nominations. Now, West Side Story could do well when the critics' winners are announced. Now, that was supposed to be January 9th with a national telecast, but the whole thing is postponed right now due to the Omicron situation. Not a good one, as I don't have to tell you. So no new date has been set yet, but of course we'll keep you posted. Now, if it should do very well in the Critics' Choice Awards in multiple categories, that would put West Side Story on a very good Oscar track. The votes, if you can add up the votes from various branches of the Academy, that can help in the Academy's, let's say, Byzantine preferential voting system. Nobody can quite explain how that works, and when they try, it takes forever, so I'm not going to try. But let's just say it's better in the system the Academy uses to be liked by lots of people than to be loved by just a few. So that's how they say it works. Meanwhile, West Side Story has already won for Best Actress for Rachel Zegler, who plays Maria, from the National Board of Review, and it's already won for cinematographer Janusz Kaminski from the New York Film Critics Circle, and who knows, if the other branches of the Academy should decide they like West Side Story, editing, sound, hair and makeup, costumes, you name it, that could add up to something that would, you know, perhaps bring some very serious Oscar gold to West Side Story. We'll be focusing on that. Now, next week on Box Office Autopsy, we will check out the 355's opening, and we'll shine our Oscar Outlook spotlight on Warner Brothers and Legendary Entertainment's Dune. Until then, thanks very much for listening. Time now for our film flashback look at what was happening in Hollywood right around now, way back then. Let's set today's time travel dial for January 7th, 1873. If it weren't for Adolf Zukor, who was born January 7th, 1873, Hollywood might never have started making feature-length movies. Zukor, a native of Hungary, lost his parents while very young. At 16, the Orphans Board advanced him $40, and he left for New York. Visiting Chicago for 1892's Columbian Exposition, he found work in the novelty fur business. A few years later, he moved his now prosperous fur enterprise to New York, where fate led him to the fledgling film industry. A cousin asked Zukor for a $3,000 loan in 1903 to buy into a New York arcade showing Edison inventions like phonographs, electric lights, and peep shows. Zukor made the loan and wound up going into arcades himself as a side venture to selling furs. He opened Automatic Vaudeville on 14th Street, a busy center for arcades and saloons. It did over $100,000 in year one, and Zukor expanded to Boston, Newark, and Philadelphia. By 1906, he'd turned the arcade's top floor into a theater showing short films on a screen. What made Zucker a movie mogul was his idea to show films much longer than 20 minutes, the industry standard then. He recognized the potential of making features starring famous players in famous plays. His new company, Famous Players, started in 1912 by distributing the French production Queen Elizabeth with stage star Sarah Bernhardt. Zucker, always the showman, opened it at New York's Lyceum, a legitimate theater, where the 44-minute-long movie was a big hit. A year later, Zucker joined forces with powerful theater producers Charles and Daniel Frohman to cast stage stars in movies of plays whose rights were controlled by the Frohmans. By 1913, Zucker had produced five features, including The Prisoner of Zenda and The Count of Monte Cristo. In 1916, he merged with the company run by Jesse L. Lasky, who produced the 1914 drama The Squaw Man, to form Famous Players Lasky, the major source of product for its distributor, Paramount Pictures. Plotting from the start to control Paramount, Zucker quietly acquired Paramount shares until he could install Hiram Abrams, a film distributor from Maine, to replace W.W. Hodgkinson as president. Hodgkinson had created Paramount's logo by recalling a snow-capped Wasatch Range mountain peak from his childhood in Utah. As for the name Paramount, he'd seen that on a New York apartment building. Zucker's ups and downs could and have filled books. When he died in July 1976 at 103, he'd outlived his many rivals, going back to the movie industry's earliest days. And that's it for today's podcast. Thanks for listening. We'll be back with another box office autopsy next week. In Hollywood for Screendollars, I'm Martin Grove.